Can I get your attention now? Don't make me put you in a minecart. I've already done it to your classmates. I have the materials right here. I'll be happy to do it. Are you going to pay attention now? That's what I thought. All right. So as I was saying, as mad scientists, we both have an obligation and a dedication to being scientific and following normal scientific methods and methodologies. And, of course, we have a certain penchant for the ludicrous, the insane, just the ridiculous, if you will. It's kind of the fun of the job. And that's what makes being a mad scientist an enjoyable profession, one that you can embrace and dedicate yourself to on a daily basis. For example, do you know if you can macerate pants or not? Don't look at your classmates for answers. They're ignoring me, and they don't know anyways. The answer is no, you cannot. And how do we know this? That's right, science. Science provides us with the answers to all of life's important questions, whether it be the maceratable state of clothing or how to build a proper nuclear containment area, which is what we're going to be focusing today's class on. And of course, as part of this, we're going to be doing lots and lots of explosions. Evil laughter is covered in a more advanced mad scientist course, but it's definitely a must-have for any would-be mad scientist. So, without any further ado, let's cue the music. Now, to better understand my particular fascination with this particular subject, we need to turn back the hands of time for a moment, and to do something that all mad scientists like to aspire to do, time travel. And we need to go back from when my base looked like this, to when it looked like this. And to kind of understand what was going on around this particular point in time in my base's history, you have to understand that in Feed the Beast, you constantly need resources to build the different machines that you want to be able to, you know, create the different cool parts of your base that you're really excited about. Now, you can, of course, do this doing mining, but as we saw with the tin factory, a lot of times you can use the machines themselves to help generate resources. And at this particular time, I was using a mass fabricator to generate UU matter, which is, of course, used to create a myriad of different substances. Unfortunately, at this particular time, my nuclear reactor wasn't quite up to snuff, and so it was draining a lot of its fuel attempting to create UU matter so that I could create other devices for my base. Now, I'd gone through pretty much all of my thorium and my uranium doing this, and I had some plutonium cells just sitting around doing nothing. Now, I had run some dual plutonium cells through my reactor before, and I didn't have any adverse effects. And I had recently set up a nice industrial information display that could give me readouts as to the temperature and things like that, and I thought, okay, well, I feel very safe with this particular setup, so let's go ahead and load it up and have a go at it. So I went ahead, loaded it up, and I sat there and monitored the temperature for a while. And once I was done doing that, I, of course, went to go work on my base and, you know, improve some of the systems that I was developing. Unfortunately, while I was off doing that, la 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 because this is the most important part of your reactor. And it, of course, is your fuel and your cooling system. And while that wonderful information display may display a nice cool temperature of 10 degrees, in here it's a completely different story. Because while I'm off working, la 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 la, my cooling cells are starting to degrade. And as I work away, they continue to get hotter and hotter and hotter. And once those cooling cells get to an excessive temperature, they just disappear. And the problem with this kind of a nuclear setup, once they disappear, our heat exchangers no longer have anything to pull heat from, which then makes all of our cooling options completely ineffective. So suddenly, while you're working away, your base goes from looking nice and cool with this nuclear reactor in the center to like this, which doesn't make you happy, especially once you realize that the corners that you quite literally cut in the construction of this to make it more round and a lot cooler on the outside caused a lot of issues and caused your base to be destroyed even further than it would otherwise have been. So, for today, what we're going to be focusing our attention on is trying to build a better nuclear reactor containment area so that your base will not end up looking like a nuclear crater. So, with that in mind, let's go on to our test area. All right. So, we are obviously, we kind of pride ourselves here on being a bit of a mad scientist. And as part of that, we need labs to test things in, even if they're just silly different experiments. Now, this one is actually practical. So, hey, bonus. But, yeah. The purpose of this area is essentially to blow things up in a very safe and uniform way. And for the purposes of a full disclosure, this is an area that I set up and have been doing some testing on already. I had intended on including you on that, but unfortunately my recording software has been having some issues today. And so I've had to junk several recording sessions because of that. So I apologize for you missing out on some of the fun. However, there's plenty more to be had, and we can get started now. As you can see here, we have a 256 by 256 square stone slab that I have affectionately dubbed the Minehattan Project. And this is, of course, in reference to the Manhattan Project, famously, run by the U.S. government during World War II, that had scientists like Oppenheimer and Einstein and people like that developing nuclear weapons for them. Now, obviously, they were interested in causing nuclear explosions as well, but our purposes are a little bit different because we're not planning on weaponizing this technology. Rather, we're trying to keep it from blowing us up in the process. So you can see here, I have a test set up with a nuclear reactor as a horn goes off outside. A nuclear reactor with 14 quad plutonium cells and lots of these containment reactor plating. Now, I've already done a test with this, and this is... Oh, I need to put myself back in cheat mode. Alrighty. There we go. Alright, so, I've done a test with this, and this was way too much. Like, it didn't even break the seal, or break any of the blocks around here. So what we're going to be doing is we're going to reduce this count to 8. And really, the better way to do this is just to get rid of some of these and split these up. This may still be too many, but if so, we will redo the test once again for science. So let's keep splitting these up essentially what this, I did some tests with the containment reactor plate. I hadn't, to be honest, messed with them very much in the past. But they seem to do a very good job of controlling explosions. And as you can see, they stack very nicely. So the point of this, and actually there's probably a better way to do this test now that I think about it. So we may change this a little bit. The point of this is basically to see if the configurations of the plates themselves makes a difference in how well they protect. So let's see. That's 16, 24, 32, 40. All right. 48. I think this will work out. So we get 64 there. And we will have, looks like 32, two stacks of 64, and then 32. All right, so we will arrange those in no particular manner because this is our test to see if it, if they will offer the same protection regardless of their configuration. Now, you may be saying, you know, you could just read the wiki on a lot of this, and I could, and that is useful. I mean, it is a useful resource that I go to quite a bit. However, the issue is a lot of these different types of these different mods were not particularly designed to work together. So we need two stacks of that and then one of that. And then we'll need 20. So let's see, 128 plus that, 160, so 8 each, I do believe. I think that's right. Well, yeah, we divided by 8 before. So yeah, so 8 each. And we will get rid of these. But yeah, I could just read the wiki, but the thing with that is, A, this is a lot more fun. I don't know. For me, I enjoy... Darn it. I'll just start over. I hate it when I do that. For me, this is a lot more fun. I enjoy doing the testing. Sometimes you can find out different things that, you know, maybe weren't anticipated when you check things in the wiki. But yeah, this is... Plus, this makes a better video, so for my purposes, where I'm trying to, I guess, in some way, entertain, inform, educate, something along those lines, you know, it's interesting, and then two, there are some things that aren't going to be very well documented, and we'll kind of cover one of those in a second. So, all right, we have the same number here as we have over there, and let's see if it makes a difference, but before we do that, let's cover... something that I personally found interesting because it makes protecting my nuclear area or my nuclear reactor area a lot less expensive. So here you can see we have a containment area set up with hardened glass. And over on the other side, we have one set up with reinforced glass. Now, our nuclear reactor has a total of 4 quad plutonium cells. Obviously, there's no cooling because we actually want this to explode. And the thing that makes this a good test is because these two sets of glass come from two separate mods. So, for example, the reinforced glass uses the advanced alloy for... Oh, I gotta go back into recipe mode. There we go. Sure, there's a hotkey for that, but I'm not going to mess with that right now. But you can see you need 2 advanced alloy to create 7 reinforced glass with, you know, 7 normal panes of glass. This, is, of course, requires 2 mixed metal ingots, which is produced via 3 bronze, 3 refined iron, and 3 tin. To me, that's really expensive. And these are all resources that I have a hard time keeping in stock. And as I'm planning on kind of doing probably 3 of these daisy chained together, 3 of these reactors, this is going to be a lot of glass and reinforced material to create this containment area. And that's a lot of resources right there. However, I have lots and lots of lead and obsidian. Is very easy to come by because you can use something like an igneous extruder, or if you use a quarry, a lot of times you'll get a lot of obsidian from that. And with the hardened glass, it uses pulverized obsidian, which you can, of course, create using a pulverizer, and pulverized lead. And this is actually a much better material for containment areas than the reinforced glass. Now, I personally like the look of the reinforced glass a bit more, but it's one of those things where, you know, I don't have to pay so much for it, and I can use resources that I'm not using for other stuff. So, yeah. So we've already run this test, this particular test, but one thing I wanted to try was cutting the corners on these, on this structure to see how it changed the explosion. Now, I may show you a clip, if I still have the video file around, of the explosion that we observed before. Essentially, on with this glass here, anywhere where it was double paned, essentially, the blast was completely contained, and the only areas that it got out was in the corners. Now, the reason, by the way, that I'm doing this test is in my other in my original reactor container, I cut corners like this, and I ended up with these blast areas that shot out at odd angles, and I'm kind of wondering if it was because of how I built the structure. That, and I did use the reinforced glass. So what I want to do is I want to clear this out and completely, and just make it so that there isn't any double layering. Now, obviously, in a future reactor containment area, I'm probably not going to use this much glass, and I will probably make it so that there is double painting in the corners, but I'm just curious what difference it makes. So there we go. All of those corners, I think, are chopped out now. And we will go over and do the same over here. So this is, of course, our command bunker, or our control center, whatever you want to call it, nuclear fallout shelter. And you can see that we have these remote thermal monitors set up. They use the reactor sensor location cards and range upgrades because these reactors are actually a pretty good distance away. Obviously, we're running pipe to carry the signal to them. And we also have the industrial information displays to output like temperature and things like that, as well as the energy output. Now, one thing about these is sometimes these are really slow to update if you make changes, and I don't know if it's just because of the distances involved. I'm using these world anchors, which are part of the railcraft mod, to keep the chunks around the nuclear reactors actually active even when we're no longer in range. But regardless, if they don't update immediately, just pick them up and put them back in, and it causes them to automatically update for you. Usually it's not much of an issue, but just a little trick if you run into that problem where you're like, why isn't it displaying properly? And, you know, it's a quick but dirty fix. Now, the great thing about these remote thermal monitors is you can put in a maximum temperature, and if they exceed that maximum temperature, they will emit a redstone signal. Now, this redstone signal can be used for multiple things. Right here, we're using it. As you can see, we have a torch above it that's automatically turned off. But when that exceeds that particular temperature, it will turn on and these howler alarms will go off. This is great if you're going AFK and you have a nuclear reactor running, or, you know, if you're just working in your base and you want to know if there, you know, if it starts to exceed a particular temperature. So, obviously here we have a shutoff switch for those in case they get too annoying, but we won't worry about that right now. So let's first start with these two reactors here in the end, and we'll turn them on. Now there is a slight delay just because of the distance from when you hit the switch to when they actually turn on, and you can hear the howler alarms go off, and they pretty much go up instantly. The joy of instantaneous explosions on demand. All right, so let's see what kind of damage was done. Nothing. I'm going to have to redo this test again. Ah! I mean... Oh! Oh! Interesting! Interesting, interesting, interesting. We have a test result. So this area, we surrounded the nuclear cells with the, whatever plates those are. What are they? The containment reactor plating. There we go. And we actually surrounded it around the plutonium cells. And on this one, we did not. We just put them haphazardly around. And yeah, you can see a huge difference. This, by the way, is a glitch. But see, this is the normal explosion area. So it does make a difference with their arrangement in the reactor itself. Very, very interesting. And as you can see, it's almost always 30 blocks across. So that's 2, 3, wahaha. 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16. No, 15. Yeah, that's 15. 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22, 23, 24, 25, 26, 27, 28, 29, 30. So yeah, that does actually make a difference. Interesting. Now, what originally inspired me to do this kind of testing is I had thought, because you can use the high-capacity heat plating, which increases the total heat that the reactor can take. And I was wondering if you use that, if it would actually cause a lot larger explosion if the reactor did actually melt down. Because in real-world nuclear dynamics and thermodynamics, it just means that the reactor is storing up more energy, which means that the size of the resulting explosion, if it does go well nuclear, is going to be larger because there's more energy stored up in the reactor itself. A lot of it in the form of heat, obviously. So let's go ahead and we will do these tests and just see how they come out as well. So we'll do that one and that one. All right. There we go. Thankfully, all of these occur pretty quickly. And let's see what happened here. So more or less, nope, actually this is a lot worse. Before there was a lot more of the side paneling left, but this is what I exhibited in my world. We had random shoots coming out of the reactor like this on a diagonal, and that apparently is resulting from the us cutting the corners on the containment area. So that's definitely something that we'll want to avoid in our actual final result, because yeah, this is a lot worse. A lot more of the glass is removed, but you can see that the ceiling and the floor for the most part are still there. You can see that the floor was double layered around the water, but obviously it blew out the bottom area, so now the water is seeping through. So let's go check over with the reinforced glass. I'm assuming it'll be a lot worse, but you never know. So let us see. You can see some stippling at the top. And yeah, it's a lot worse. So yeah, this is what I was talking about before. You can see that you're getting like a lot more of this glass is blown out. And really, you only have vague remnants of the top and the bottom remaining. And it looks like the distances are pretty much the same, but before, yeah, this looks very similar in terms of the removal of the stone blocks. But yeah, it's very much one of those things where it does seem like the hardened glass is a much better choice for this particular type of design. I really wish this was better, because I do like how they look, but they're so expensive. So, all right, well, that definitely confirms that result. A, if you're building a nuclear containment area, make sure that you've all your corners are like that and not like that. I know that it makes a difference with gas. I didn't realize it would make such a big difference with this. It's definitely one of those things where the blast will come out the corners and cause a lot more destruction than it would otherwise. And obviously with the, man, that's a big hole. That's a really big hole. Obviously with the, with this, you want to make sure that your reactor containment plating is surrounding the actual radioactive cells themselves and not just placed willy-nilly about, because otherwise they definitely lose their effectiveness. All right, and we are back, and we are apparently in the middle of an Ender blizzard because... yeah, lots of purple snowflakes everywhere. This is a result of me editing this world to create the giant stone block, I'm guessing, because I've had some issues with some of the other, with some of the different mods in Feed the Beast, due to that, I think, as well. More specifically, Computercraft. But regardless, we are going to be continuing with our testing, and you can see here we have a room set up, and to save both you and myself some time, I did this with obsidian, like a half and half, with obsidian blocks and construction foam. Now, if you're not familiar with construction foam, it's actually kind of cool. You put it down, and it will eventually harden into a surface like this, which you can then, if I can find it, let's go to industrial craft. But once it's hardened, you can then, you know, pick whatever paint you want and you can actually paint it. So that's pretty cool. So it makes it nice and decorative. It's also supposed to be pretty blast proof. The other nice thing about it is it kind of works like facades for pipes. So in other words, you can get one of these CF sprayers filled up with CF pellets. There's also a backpack that you can use that works similar to like a lap pack or something like that. But then you can spray it into an area. Now, that was not a very good job with that, but it will actually surround cables, and so it's another way that you can hide things and make them more presentable. But obviously, it is kind of a pain because you do end up with overspray and a bit of an annoyance. The other issue with these is if you walk into them, you can't actually permeate them and they will do damage to you. You can actually, I think some people have used them for mob systems and things like that. So, you know, just another thing to consider. The main reason I want to look at this is because for running like wires out of the reactor room, this is a good way of increasing the amount of durability, basically, those have if there is ever an explosion, so you don't have, you know, things flying out. Now, as we make our way over here, I have set up another area with more traditional materials. You can see here we have the reinforced stone, and then I think it's... oh, I missed a corner. The iridium enriched stone or something like that? Iridium reinforced stone. I've never used this, so I don't know exactly what it is. Actually, let's go into recipe mode for a second. Done. Okay, so it's reinforced stone plus an iridium ingot, so that's pretty expensive. But I thought, just, you know, since we're in creative and we can do all sorts of different things, why not just see how good it is? Over here, I've used some things that I don't think will fare very well. Let me clear out my inventory. That I don't think will fare very well, but I thought I'd go ahead and use them just because I have another test area set up. Why not? And you can see here we have a steel block, which I don't actually know if it's something that you can use in the game because it does not have a placement sound. So that's usually a sign that you can't do that, or maybe there's a different way of placing it other than by hand. We also have titanium, dark iron blocks, and lead blocks. Now, it would make sense for the lead blocks to be pretty good in this type of application, but I don't know. I don't know if they're designed to do that, but I thought I'd go ahead and set it up since it just takes a few minutes. Again, we've segmented things out. As I said, I don't really expect these to do particularly well, so I just thought I'd combine them all together. And over here, we have our last reactor room. By the way, all of these are set up with four quad plutonium cells. And you can see here, I've actually done a room in enchanting tables because, again, we're in creative. Why not? And it goes kind of with that whole mad scientist thing. Over here, we do have a more traditional block with concrete. Again, this is one that doesn't have a sound, but I'm guessing it's probably, if it's in the game, it's probably one of those things where you have to pour it. So, with all those now placed and ready to go, we can get back to blowing things up. So, let's go over here and set off our nuclear reactions. I guess maybe this is ash. Oh, maybe it's these things that are causing it. Interesting. But anyways, let's go ahead and throw these on and blow some things up. All right, all of our testing is done. That was easy. And now let's go and check out the results. Okay. It does not appear that concrete or enchanting tables are particularly good. Oh, goodness. Oh, my goodness. No, definitely do not use concrete or enchanting tables for your nuclear containment facility. That would be really bad. It's odd that it went, like, there's more of it, the energy went down rather than to the sides. That's kind of interesting. I wonder if you could potentially build in floors that were supposed to fail specifically for the purposes of directing the blast away from your components. It looks like obsidian did the same, and yeah, the construction foam, despite being said to be blast-proof, does not seem to be nuke-proof particularly, which would kind of make sense given its foam. But regardless, not really a surprise there. And let's go over here and check this one out. Oh, interesting. It looks like, well, yeah, the iridium reinforced stone definitely held up pretty well. So yeah, if you have lots of iridium laying around, this is definitely the way to go. I don't think there's any blocks of the iridium reinforced stone missing. However, the reinforced stone itself, yeah, that's that didn't fare too well. Alrighty. And last but not least, let's go check out the lead, the steel. Oh, goodness. Titanium actually survived pretty well. It doesn't look like the titanium broke down at all, in fact. What's required for titanium, I wonder? Again, one of these other blocks that I have never messed with much. So it's going to be a titanium ingot. Oh, I hate when they do this. Let's see. Titanium dust. Okay, well, you could use U matter for it. That's not terrible. But it's two blocks for five of it. That's not a particularly good return. I wonder if there's another way to make it. Let's see. I may have to look that up off camera in a second. But yeah, the titanium definitely held up pretty well. Dark iron though, lead, steel blocks, not so much. So, all right, one more test out of the way. To be honest, so far, and it's kind of surprising, but the hardened glass seems to actually be the best solution. Maybe reinforce it with some of the reinforced stone. That might be a good solution. I may have to play around with it a bit. I've got one or two more tests that I want to do just for, the sake of being thorough. But yeah, it definitely seems like the hardened glass right now, which is pretty easy to make, seems to be the best solution. Now, I will say I have made the hardened glass before. It is kind of time consuming, but if you were to set up a machine to produce it for you and just went AFK or worked on other things while it processed the lead and the obsidian, it probably wouldn't be too bad. So that may definitely be a solution there. All right, I'm going to go once again and reload the world file, set up one more test, and may build one more thing just to figure out how well it works. So once again, I will be back in a moment, and we will conclude this video in a bit. All right, guys, I am back, and it's been a while, actually. My girlfriend actually was calling me to make sure that I was actually okay, because I had told her I was going to start recording, and it was like 10 hours later, and she was like, "I haven't heard from you," and I was like, "Oh, oops, completely lost track of time." But anyways, darn it, we're gonna have to wait for this to set. Essentially, all I wanted to do for my last test was, well, there's actually one extra special test after this, but for our last primary test, I should say, or preliminary test, is I wanted to go ahead and set up an just a door and some piping going through the wall to see how it would augment this particular result, because as we saw before, this type of block does not seem to be really negatively affected at all by explosions or anything of that nature. So I wanted to see just to by adding a door and some wire through the wall, if that would in the end affect our results too negatively. I could have tested over here, but before we tested it, the wall here just completely obliterated. So yeah, that was not a good test area. And I thought this we can at least see how much of an impact it'll have just having these two holes right here. So we're gonna wait for that to set real quickly. And while that's doing that, and you may have already seen it out of the corner of your eye, when I was up here before, come on, set. I went ahead and I started work on based on the kind of the research that we were doing here and the results that we found, started work on a new containment design that I was going to try to use. I kind of like how it looks. Obviously, it's making heavy use of the hardened glass right here, and it's obviously I kind of designed the outside layout because again, this reinforced concrete seems to be a lot weaker than the hardened glass when it comes to handling explosions. So it's basically designed to just have this more on the exterior. And obviously it's kind of got a design that I think is somewhat indicative of, I guess, a power outlet or a socket or a plug or whatever you want to call it. And American standard, obviously. And, you know, I thought that was pretty fitting for this type of a facility. Obviously, it's very much layered, and I'll give you a look on the inside real quickly, although I definitely want to make some changes to it now that I've kind of built it. Obviously, this is a lot of resources dedicated to that, but it, I think, will be worth it. Oh, come on. Will be worth it if it keeps my whole base from exploding. And plus, it kind of looks, it looks pretty cool, because, again, I kind of wanted to make it look like, you know, a plug, and then the upper portion sort of looks like a socket, and then, the outputs, which are obviously encased in this, construction foam, and here I have a pipe. This is the one that I really want to change, because I hate that it looks differently than the other ones. I can't do anything with it because the you're really limited on the types of facades you can use, and you really only have the stock facades for blocks that are, you know, in vanilla Minecraft, which is kind of disappointing because you do get a couple of different more types of blocks with the Feed the Beast mod, so it would be nice if you could do something with those. In terms of for decorative, and this is obviously going to take forever, so while this is going on, we can go ahead and kind of take a look on the inside. Now, again, this is not finalized. This was just kind of a rough layout. Basically, I wanted to be able, because I'm pretty sure that hole in the wall is going to cause a big problem. So what I wanted to do was run everything vertically and up and out. And that prevents us, that means we can kind of cap off this area where the actual reactors will be stored. Because this whole design is obviously designed to be somewhat modular and stackable. So i.e. if we take out this floor, you can put another one of these underneath. And it should work to help protect the reactor above. But I've been very anxious to test this design, but I did wait on you guys. I have not tested it already. As you can see, I have the scaffolding here for, since I do play in creative, and I don't have a jetpack as of right now, but I have that for getting in and out, which these have to be one of my favorite new blocks in the game. I love these scaffolding. They're just so useful, and I love the fact that you can just climb on them like that and get in and out of areas very nicely. Down here, again, it's very rough, but you can see that this is where our pipe comes in, and this is what we're actually transmitting power through. I may also be able to do something where it can pipe, you know, depleted uranium cells out and then new uranium cells in. But I think I'll probably run the power output and this pipe on the same side, because that will reduce the amount of water flow I'm restricting. It obviously can't go right underneath because there would be only one point for it to really hit. And if I just do it here, it should just restrict one stream, I think. Again, it's something I'm going to have to play with. I kind of wish you could run power through pipes, like EU type of power, but I don't believe that you can, unfortunately. But you can obviously see it running underneath the floor and coming up, and this is obviously where it toggles. You can see that the water itself that is cooling, helping to cool this, is obviously more than five blocks above. And above that, we have more hardened glass to help protect the upper area from any explosions that might happen down below. Beyond that, obviously the power's run through the construction foam using fiber optic cable. I'll probably change this to a single piece because I'm in creative, you know, and I don't have to worry about supply limitations, but in my actual world, I will. And I think you probably noticed, but I used the titanium on the front here. Just kind of more of a decorative thing. Speaking of which, I did find out how to make titanium, and actually I had made it previously, and I had just forgotten. You just use, I think it's 24 bauxite, and I forget the number of tins. I think you have to use empty cells or something like that. But it's basically through a centrifuge. It's the same process that produces aluminum, and that also results in one titanium. So since I have tons and tons of bauxite, I think, to be honest, I haven't checked my bauxite supply since my nuclear reactor blew up, so who knows, I may be completely out. But I may be able to do that, or I may want to use the titanium for something else. I don't know what all it's used for, really, to be honest. Which probably is a sign that it's not used for too much, but I could be wrong. And obviously, this is going to... Darn you. Darn you. Alright. To be honest, I'm pretty sure we've seen how well this works before, even when it is set. I'm not going to worry about it too much. It's really late. I've been working on this a good bit today. And I'm just ready to get this kind of done with, and so I can get back into normal survival mode and start building. So we're going to real quickly just go ahead and blow her up and see what having those two holes does. Because really, I don't think that construction foam offers much resistance anyways. So let's go ahead and do that. So goodbye. Oh, this is probably drained out of power, too. I need to swap those batteries. But, doesn't matter. Alrighty. So, let's see what kind of damage we got done here. Similar to hole to before. And... the door is gone. Oh, goodness, yeah. Well, now, the door, it didn't... let's put down a torch. The door seemed to do pretty well, but yeah, so that's kind of what I figured with this. Now, maybe having the construction... Yeah, see, that's a big hole, just from that one block being missing. So, yeah, that's definitely running it vertically, I think, is the better choice. So that just kind of reaffirms my previous design decision when it came to this. So, what we're going to do for this test, and again, this one worries me, we're going to take out the cooling cells, and we're going to throw in our maximum load of 4 quad plutonium, and we're going to see if how badly this thing will... go up when that happens, because I'm pretty sure we'll leave in the containment reactor plating, because that would be there even if the if all the cooling and everything failed. That would still be there to help repress any particular, you know, any potential explosions. We'll try to spread it out a little bit more evenly, since we did show that it does seem to make a difference. So there we go. We have plating all around. There we go. All around these cells. Do I really? No, I'll leave it like it was. I don't want to throw this off, because again, the point is to make it explode and see if this can hold it. So let's not throw off the results by getting cheaty. That said, I will reinforce this floor. I worry about it coming up at me. So we will Well, actually, I need to do those with the corners. Yeah. This definitely has me a bit worried. And to make me a little bit more worried, this may be a bad idea, but let's switch the game mode to survival and see if I would survive if this blew up and I was up here. All right, guys, hold on to your seats. This is going to be bad. Oh, come on. Come on. No. Oh, goodness. That's not good. And I'm irradiated. Oh, goodness. But it held. Okay, I lost a lot of stuff. Yeah, you can see all the wiring is destroyed, but the containment area held. Yay! And I'm dying to radiation, and I'm gonna drown. But, I mean, yeah, it held. I mean, really, oh, that's so great. Oh, yeah, this is my new design. Oh, we gotta get, I'm gonna switch back to, creative. I had to think, okay, see, this is how tired I am. I'm like, creative, that's one, right? All right, yes, so good. I mean, you saw the amount of damage that did out there. With a level with 4 quad plutonium. Now, we did have the containment cells in there, or containment plating, 8 of them. It held. There's definitely some damage, but this would not be a giant nuclear crater. I might be irradiated. I might be dying to radiation. Let's see underneath real quickly. Oh, yes. Perfect. Woohoo! All right, so yeah, this is... some variation of this is definitely the design I'm going with. Because, yeah, that just worked perfectly. As you can see, I've got, like... Here at the corners, I've got, like, 3 layers of this hardened glass... in the center, I've got 2. Everywhere, I've got 2. I did lose some hardened glass down here. But really, 1, 2, 3, 4. All right, we've got to do this again. Just real quickly, I'm going to reload it. And I want to take out the containment plating, and I want to do this test again and just see how it goes, because yeah, that's amazing. Sorry about shaking your view there, just excited. All right, so let me go ahead and I will load the save file and we will do this again, and this will probably terminate my very good mood because it'll probably explode and kill me horribly. So I will be back in 1 second. Alright guys, so we are back for our last test. And I'm going to go ahead and you can see we have our quad plutonium cells in. I'm going to make this quick because I know this is going to be a long video. And in fact, I have a question for you regarding that as soon as this is done. But let's go ahead up here. We're going to do this really quickly. Just see how bad it is. We've already got 1 good test result. And we'll do the same thing. And the reason I'm putting, part of the reason I'm putting myself in the, into survival is because I just want to see how badly this would hurt me if I were right here. So let's go ahead. Okay, this still worries me, but we've had one good test result. Go! Oh, I didn't put more on the floor. Oh, this is going to be bad. I was nuked. Oh, that was bad. Oh, goodness. Yeah. So those containment plating, that makes a big difference. So let's see. How badly was this hurt? I didn't put the extra glass up top. I think that hurt me. Oh, goodness. Okay, well, the exterior seems to be fine. No breaches. So if this were an actual scenario, we wouldn't have a giant hole anywhere in our base. We would just have to repair this. Let's see. Alright. Obviously, lots of wiring once again. And yeah, you can, it definitely took out more of the glass and things here. You can see here that this was in the corners it was taken out, and here, and all of this. But it did actually hold it. So, and yeah, there was more glass down here. And I don't think any of this, No, definitely some water was taken out. But definitely an easy rebuild. So, well, easier rebuild. So yeah, this is definitely, I'm going to do something like this in my survival world for my actual containment building. Because yeah, this does a really good job of containing it. And while it did kill me, it wouldn't have really done that much damage. So, yeah, two successful tests. Great, 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 great. No big holes anywhere. This makes me extremely happy. Now, with that out of the way, having successfully tested that, I have a couple of questions for you. And, you know, I'd appreciate... Look, I don't do this YouTube thing very much, and so I'm really... I don't quite know what you guys want. I can't say I'm always going to post videos because, you know, I just tend to post things when I find something interesting or when I want to investigate something and I think someone else might have an interest in it as well. But if I do post a video, as you've probably noticed, I tend to make them kind of long. This is partially because I'm very long-winded, as you can probably tell, but it's also because I just, you know, I want to put a lot of information in there, and I tend to like to do a, you know, project from start to finish in a single video. Now, I know people like Etho don't do that, and I'm not saying anything there's wrong with that. In fact, that's what I'm going to ask you. What do you guys prefer? Would you prefer I split up the videos into multiple parts? Do you prefer the longer format? I know with Etho, I sometimes wish his videos would be longer, because by the time you're really kind of getting into the project, he's like, well, I don't have a lot of time to record today, so I'm done. And it's like, no, but maybe it's good to leave people wanting more. I don't know. You know, I could try it different ways. But yeah, just let me know. Also, the other thing is, when it comes to posting the videos, like before when I posted my other Feed the Beast video, I went ahead and posted on the Minecracks forums because it was, you know, I thought relevant to what Etho had been doing. But like this is kind of my own thing. So I wouldn't feel comfortable posting it there due to that. But I don't necessarily feel that the, like, on Reddit seems to provide the best results, and I just feel like blowing some stuff up again. Reddit seems to produce the best results, but I don't necessarily know if posting to like the general Minecraft channel is necessarily the best idea, because I really don't think that's probably the people that are going to be interested in what I'm doing. So there is, weird, because I know there was a reactor, but anyways, so my question is, where do you guys tend to you know, look for new video content? I know obviously on YouTube, that's where I generally go, but I mean, if you're just, you know, clicking on random links or whatever, where do you guys usually browse around for new content? Because I really have no idea where to post things, and I don't want to really, you know, like, I'm not trying to scam off anyone or anything like that, so I don't want to post, this stuff really did not hold up very well. I don't want to post somewhere, like, on the Minecraft Reddit, where, obviously, that's not what it's there for. And so, yeah, just, I guess if you have any ideas or suggestions as to where I could post video content, because I'm really not, I do this kind of for fun on the side, and obviously I get into it, I enjoy doing it, but I don't really know how to find people that have, I guess, some more interest to my own, and to post content where they might be able to find it if they want to watch it. If they don't, fine. I'm not really trying to, like, necessarily build a YouTube channel here or anything like that. I'm just posting stuff because I find it entertaining, and I hope that other people, you know, do as well. So, you know, it's kind of a shared collective thing. So yeah, I guess if you have any suggestions in regards to that, I would greatly appreciate it. I feel like I'm completely clueless in that area, and so you guys probably have a much better idea as to where to post things than I do. So anyways, I know this has been a long video. I apologize for that. I may end up segmenting some of it up into two videos. I haven't quite decided about that. Regardless, I guess, just, keep your eyes open. And if you see a couple posts from me, then you'll know that that was the other video that I was going to kind of incorporate into this before this became like a marathon session. So anyways, this is Andrew and Price. Thanking you for watching. Hopefully you enjoyed it, you know, found it entertaining, educational, et cetera, et cetera. And, thanks once again for watching. I really do appreciate it. And I don't know how many of you have stuck around. Please tell me this is a glitch. Yes. Okay. But for this whole thing, but I mean, you know, I appreciate you guys that, you know, seem to like my previous video, and I'm definitely trying to post, you know, some other stuff for you guys since you seem to react so favorably to it. So, let me, if you have any thoughts, suggestions, comments, I promise I'm generally pretty responsive, and, just let me know what you guys think. So, once again, this is Andrew and Price thanking you for watching. I'm actually going this time, I promise. And saying good night and good gaming. Bye.